just do a couple of acknowledgements first, to recognize and acknowledge that we're on the unceded territories of the Algonquin people, and we've had great collaboration with our Algonquin partners, and I recognize Norm from Kitigan-Zibi, a board member from Algonquin Nation, Kwekatina Amigwetch. I also want to just acknowledge Sarah Jane, who's not with us today, and Tanya Gracie, who had a baby, and I'm telling you, the NCC gets into your veins, and once you've been on the board, it becomes to the point where she named her son Toby. So, I think it's the exact same spelling. So, Toby, obviously, you've had a material effect, and I think the NCC's had a material effect. So, Tanya is recovering it now, and we wish her and her son Toby, her family, the very best. Mairesse Bellil peut pas être avec nous.
Mayor Bellil will not be able to be with us today, but the floods that are expected in Gatineau from the Outaouais River, we would like to thank the mayor. We had the opportunity to have some conversations with the mayor this week, and so she certainly wanted to be here, but we understand the situation that is occupying her at the moment because of the river. And we wish everyone good luck in the next few days. I know it is very stressful for the people affected.
Into this morning's agenda, declaration of conflicts of interest.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I declare conflict for the LeBreton Fund.
Thank you, Norman. Given that the it is in public, you are welcome to stay, but we appreciate your declaration. Any other conflicts of interest? Okay. L'adoption des les minutes.
Adoption of the minutes of the last meeting. Any questions? Any comments? Thank you, Lise. So this is adopted. First of all, I would like to welcome the new mayor, Mayor Sutcliffe, who is here, first in-person meeting.
To have you join the board. Congratulations again. We had the opportunity to welcome you on our last meeting, but that was virtual, but now in person. It's a great pleasure, and we look forward to your leadership with the City of Ottawa, but also on this board, and for your feedback and your inputs. The collaboration between the NCC and the municipalities is key, and the opportunity to have the mayors sit on the board are really instrumental in moving that collaboration forward. So appreciate you being here again today, and we'll have an opportunity to hear from you on the regional matters in a few minutes. So with that, I'll turn it over to Toby for the report on activities.
Merci Marc, bonjour tout le monde.
And good morning everyone. J'aimerais reconnaître ceux qui écoutent sur notre canal YouTube. J'espère que tout le monde.
Our Greenbelt and Gatineau Park sites were as popular as ever. We'll talk a little bit about some of the numbers later on. And of course, in the last couple of weeks, our employees and crews have been hard at work, even throughout the Easter long weekend, when an ice storm swept throughout the region and brought about widespread power outages and downed trees. Nos équipes ont aussi été très occupées par la mise à jour.
Our teams have also been busy updating development guidelines, advancing several major construction projects, and continuing our sustainability and conservation efforts in the National Capital Convention.
So I'm pleased to update you on our activities as we prepare for what promises to be a dynamic spring and summer season. So I'll go through in alignment with our corporate priorities. Je tiens à remercier spécialement.
I would like to thank the team for their contributions and for the success of the visit of the President of the United States last month.
From the photograph that lots of work was done to make the site look good. And in other news, and as announced in the fall, the abatement work at 24 Sussex Drive will start next month. This has been long planned and an important, necessary first step to stabilize the building. So turning to priority two, I'm very happy to report that planning for phase three of the Victoria Island remediation project is now underway. The NCC is focusing on the green space area west of the Portage Bridge. Construction is anticipated to start this year with a tender actually in the coming weeks. And consistent with previous phases, the procurement is aiming to encourage Algonquin participation throughout the life cycle of the project.
We are also in the phase three of the elaboration of the Sir George Etienne Cartier Park. Second round of consultation ended on February 19. I have the pleasure to announce that we have received more than 4,500 comments, which confirms the importance of ensuring the access to this land to add some buildings to make and to conserve the natural environment. The next stage of consultation will occur in the fall. The NCC is also finishing the public construction of the Brasserie River. We are talking with the City of Gatineau personnel to deal with the zoning conditions, the public consultation, and the contamination of the real estate.
We're going to work towards updating the core area sector plan. In the current context, we are exploring opportunities to repair and restitch the urban fabric, setting out objectives for architectural expression at key locations, including heritage sites and streetscapes, new government buildings and cultural institution opportunities, and we are reimagining the functioning and extent of Confederation Boulevard as a route that links both the Ottawa and Gatineau sides of the capital. I am pleased to note that in collaboration with the City of Ottawa, we are beginning work to replace and repair electrical systems along the Rideau Canal. The lighting systems within this corridor have deteriorated beyond their intended life cycle, creating health and safety concerns for the general public. And so this project will greatly improve safety on the multi-use pathways along the Rideau Canal and on Colonel By Drive and Queen Elizabeth Driveway. So the project will start this summer and is anticipated to finish in 2025. Now turning to our long-term integrated interprovincial crossings plan. Say that five times quickly. Our project plan and technical update will soon be initiated to integrate new data on the movement of people and commercial vehicles. This data collection will complement the Household Origin Destination Survey and will inform the decision-making on new interprovincial infrastructure.
Service public et Public Service and NCC are collaborating to improve the interprovincial connections of the NCC in the replacement project of Alexander Bridge. We are expecting the dismantling will begin in 2028 and will end in 2032. Concerning the Champlain Bridge, our team is started their work on March 20th and is expected to finish in November 2023, 8 months earlier than expected.
Installation of the wooden fins at Whispering Point is now complete. Concrete work on the pathways and landings has progressed well over the winter, and the bridge piers and girders are currently being fabricated at the steel plant. We anticipate the new park and bridge to be completed late this year, and we'll be talking more about this and some of our other major projects later on in the meeting. So turning to our third priority, since our last board meeting, we hosted two very successful urbanism labs. The first on new traditional architecture was held on January 26th and attracted over 1,000 participants for the live and recorded event and close to 1,400 views on YouTube. And on March 2nd, in conjunction with the European Union delegation's visit to Ottawa, we hosted a session on sustainability and the Anthropocene era and again got hundreds hundreds and hundreds of participants and viewers, which was great to see. And in fact, what this is showing us is a marked increase in our urbanism lab attendance, 73% increase compared to last year. With still many more sessions to go, we've got a session on the legacy of Frederick Todd on April 27th, the student design competition on May 24th, and Indigenous planning and design on June 15th. In addition to the Urbanism Lab series, the Canadian Capital Cities Organization 2023 winter meeting took place in January, the first time that we had met in person for 3 years. So it was great to hear from so many great speakers and panelists as they explored cultural and urban planning projects across Canada. And we co-hosted here as well as the City of Ottawa and La Ville de Gatineau. In keeping with our commitment to Indigenous engagement, on January 27th, members of the Algonquin Nation communities of both Kitigan-Zibi and Pikwaknagon performed a smudging ceremony on Victoria Island. This ceremony, which was organized by the NCC, marked another important milestone on the decontamination of this historic site. Our partners from the Algonquin Nation were consulted throughout the process leading to the decontamination and tree cutting. And interestingly, when we cut a few of the trees for this latest phase, one of the elders from Pikwaknagon noted to us that he plans to recuperate the trees to build a healing lodge near the community. So great reuse of some of those fallen trees.
The NCC has worked with students from Algonquin College to build some units in the Lac Philippe camping. These students used a new method of construction of straw walls and clay walls, which is the first time for the NCC. The walls have been built with traditional methods, and the material is low in carbon, which contributes to the carrying out of the different commitments of the NCC for sustainable development.
In keeping with our commitment to diversity, equity, and inclusion, I should note that all NCC staff have completed an introductory Gender-Based Analysis Plus, or GBA Plus course, as of March 31st. The course is designed to assist staff with identifying how GBA Plus can be used to enhance the responsiveness and effectiveness and outcomes of federal government initiatives. And building on this, GBA Plus considerations have also been integrated into the corporation's decision-making processes to ensure that teams are assessing the impacts of NCC projects and programs on different groups of people who live in and visit the National Capital Region. I'm also pleased to report that the Human Resources and Facilities Management team continues to work supporting the NCC in its implementation of the Accessible Canada Act. The team is coordinating consultations and reporting on progress to make the NCC more accessible as an organization and throughout our planning and project guidelines. And once again, Mr. Chair, I'm delighted to report that the NCC has been recognized as a top employer in the National Capital Region. This recognition is not only a testament to the NCC's flexible approach to an ever-changing workplace, but really a testament to the talented group of employees who work tirelessly to make the NCC a truly exceptional place to be and to work. So congrats to the whole staff on that front, and now I'll turn to priority four.
Après de nombreuses consultations. After many consultations, we are in the last stages of the Sustainable Development Strategy for 2023-2027. This new strategy will be in line with the federal strategy of sustainable development by taking into account the unique mandate of the NCC and its position as a partner to build a region of the national capital that is more sustainable and resilient.
Outlining the key priorities and actions of that plan. And on April 12th, an information session was held with regional stakeholders to present the strategy and discuss alignment with regional sustainable priorities. We, of course, remain committed to achieving net zero in all of our operations by 2050. And to achieve this target, we have initiated the development of our first climate mitigation plan, and a presentation on that is planned for our next meeting in June.
aussi qui concerne notre...
Concerning our commitment towards the conservation, our team of the urban lands of Quebec and of the Gatineau Park has concluded two agreements in the Gatineau Park. The first agreement concerns the purchase of Action TLC for the Respect of the Environment, ACRE, of the Jolicoeur McMartin Forest in Chelsea, and of a wooded area of 70 acres that is located in the Larrimack Corridor. The second agreement is an agreement of 4 years that will restore the paraline habitat in a sector of the Rousseau of the Miche River Valley.
With the Nature Conservancy of Canada to protect 44 acres of land in the Breckenridge Corridor. And these agreements all contribute to the Gatineau Park Master Plan's mission to protect ecological corridors that contribute to the park's biodiversity and ecological health. As for community outreach, on March the 5th, a new event titled Winter in the Park 101 was organized by the Canadian Parks and Wilderness Society. And this event centered on trail etiquette and featured nature interpretation and folk music, as well as an opportunity for those there to try snowshoeing and winter biking. And it was a big success with over 300 participants. And given that access to our natural assets is always a priority, I am pleased to report that with the steady support of the NCC's six volunteer groups, the Ontario Urban Winter Trail Network has now well over 100 kilometers of groomed trails to diversify our winter offerings. This was especially beneficial as it was the first year, of course, disappointingly, without the Rideau Canals Gateway, so underline the importance of diversifying these winter recreational opportunities. And the volunteers took full advantage of the large snowfall amounts this winter and assisted grooming efforts well past the end of March, which was great to see. So maybe I'll conclude, Mr. Chairman, by talking a little bit about some of the public events we've had in Gatineau Park over the course of the winter months. So, parmi les faits marquants de la...
During the important points of the winter season, there could be 450 new Canadians who participated in guided excursions, 620 students for different programs connected to their study programs, and a presentation of awareness to 900 students in the classrooms.
Of weekend public programming, including animal tracking on snowshoes, where again we had almost 500 people participate over the span of 9 weekends. And keeping with important facts and figures, we sold this year well over 15,000 winter season passes, providing access to our cross-country ski, snowshoe, and winter biking network, and close to 1,500 winter nights of camping. I did promise that we were going to do a board retreat at winter camping. We'll have to organize that for next year. And as spring approaches, we look forward to welcoming residents and visitors to our ever-popular and beautiful trails for walking, running, or hiking. We, of course, have something for everyone for any season to explore. And within the NCC, we look forward to an active and productive construction season to advance the many projects you'll be hearing about shortly. And with that, Mr. Chair, I'll say thank you very much.
Merci beaucoup, Toby. Thank you.
Thank you, Toby.
I'm going to miss these reports, but because it's always...
You can listen live on YouTube.
I can listen live on YouTube, and I will. But, you know, a couple of takeaways for me, certainly. The advancement of, and we'll talk about this a little bit later, but the advancement of the openness of our sites to the public, whether it's the three bistros that have been so popular, the two terraces, the Gatineau shuttle that was now not just a seasonal one, but one that's providing access to the open NCC, the parkways. It's been a tremendous feat for you and your team to be able to bring the NCC to life for our citizens who live and visit this capital. So thank you very much. Any questions or comments for Toby? Oui, Denis.
Denis, thank you. I noted in your thank you first of all for your report. Unlike the president, the chair, I will hear another one. On the Georges Thème Cartier project, you talked about consultations. I was told in the community that this is perhaps, and I hope that the group intervened in those consultations, that when working with the park, maybe there will be an opportunity to show the Francophone heritage of this area. I don't know if it was received in the comments that were sent to you. Yes, I don't know if you can join us. We had consultations with the Francophone groups, and Anna, maybe you can tell us a bit more about these discussions. Yes, thank you. This is something that from the beginning was part of the considerations. We're working with the Francophone community. I know that my colleague Alain is in conversations with these different groups, the Francophone group. So maybe we will update you outside of this meeting. But the dialogue is open and is happening. Yes, thank you. Thank you, Denis. Thank you, Véronique. Any other questions for Toby? Yes, Norm.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I had sent along some emails. Quite a few citizens reached out to me about Gatineau Park and the accessibility. And having a father who's disabled, I'm sensitive to the issue too. So they're hoping to meet with the NCC. There was a lot of reports on it in the news, and that they're hoping to meet with us to see if there's anything possible we can do to help accommodate them as well.
Yeah, absolutely, Norm. Thank you for that. We've had consultations throughout the winter months, and as mentioned, I think, by Mark, we started a summer shuttle this past season and are looking at opportunities to expand that shuttle in future years. That's going to be a very important part of our approach to the actual parkways. And then we're also expanding our offerings of different accessible modes of accessing the parkways. We have two sites now for electric bike rentals. We have electric scooters. We have special modified bicycles for accessible use, and also discussing ways in which we can continue to improve and augment those accessibility options. But yeah, we've had many consultations, and over the course of the coming weeks, we'll continue and be sure to communicate with the public on what the schedule will be for this year.
Thank you, Toby. Thank you, Norm. Any other questions or comments? Okay, seeing none, we will now move to the municipal reports. And again, I'd like to welcome Mayor Sutcliffe. As mentioned to the board this morning, I've known Mark for 20-odd years or more. Our fathers worked together. I worked with Mark's wife, and I know Mark is an inspired leader who's going to bring great cooperation and vision for the city. So very excited to have you as our relatively new mayor. I think you're 5 or 6 months into the role now, and I'm looking forward to the continued partnership between yourself and Toby and the leadership and the NCC. So we'll turn it to you for the municipal report.
Thank you, Mark. Merci. Et tout d'abord,
first of all, I'm very happy to be here with you this morning in person. It's a pleasure to meet you in person, finally. And I am looking forward to working together for the next 4 years. And I would like to thank Mark
for his leadership and passion for our community. You took this job on 6 years ago, and I know it was, you know, it's, I'm sure I've talked to you about this before. You were honored to have the opportunity, but it really was a gesture of public service and your commitment to our capital and to our city that you took on this job. So, Mark, I really want to thank you for your leadership and your commitment to making our capital better, our city stronger, and I know it's been a lot of hard work and a lot of long hours, so on behalf of the people of Ottawa, I want to thank you for that service. You know, it's a shame. I was saying earlier, you know, there's only room for one Mark S. on this board, so So somebody had to go. But but you know, it's a shame that we won't be working together for longer. But I'm excited about the new chair, and I understand there could be some new board members in the months ahead as well. So I'm looking forward to working with everyone. You know, I think there really is you know, there's a long history, obviously, with the City of Ottawa and the National Capital Commission, and sometimes it's been bumpy, and it's inevitable that there are going to be some challenges. But you know, I think there's you always have to look at it in terms of whether it's, you know, whether you can see it through the lens of obstacles or through the lens of opportunities. And I choose to look at this as an opportunity. We're blessed to have the, you know, the investment of the federal government in our capital, and it makes Ottawa a better place for all the people who live here. Sometimes there are challenges when we're trying to advance the city's interests, and maybe it takes a little longer because we have to consult with and work with the NCC, or there may be other issues that arise. But I'm confident that if we're working together and we all have the best interests of the capital at heart, that we'll be able to resolve those. And I see this, you know, I'm new, and I'm coming here with a spirit of collaboration. And I know if there are other new people around the table and a new chair, that we'll be able to get a lot of things done. So I'm looking forward to working with everyone. And I you know, I'll commit as mayor and as, you know, on behalf of the team at the City of Ottawa, that we'll be ready to work with the NCC on all the important files and all the important challenges. We had a meeting the other day where it was shared with me that there's a spreadsheet at the City of Ottawa that lists all the different files that we're working on with the National Capital Commission, and it's 35 pages long. So I see that as a good sign that we have an opportunity to work together on many things. So I'm happy to answer any questions now or later about the City of Ottawa's plans and some of the things we're working on. But my main message is simply that we're here to work together and build a better city and a better national capital for the residents of Ottawa and for all Canadians. So thank you. Merci beaucoup.
Merci beaucoup, Mayor Sutcliffe.
Thank you, Mayor Sutcliffe. It's certain that we have the same hope to have the cooperation and the collaboration with you and with Mayor Belil and the municipalities and the region of the capital for Canadians, and also for the citizens and the residents.
And certainly I know Toby is a great collaborator and his team, so please keep those lines of communication as open as possible and the collaboration ongoing. It's a great partnership and one that will only continue to improve and get better, so appreciate your leadership. Any questions or comments for Mayor Sutcliffe? Okay, well, thank you again and welcome. Comme j'ai indiqué, la mairesse.
As I indicated, Mayor Belil has to deal with the flooding situation in her municipality, and so we won't be receiving her report this morning, but Toby and I will have the opportunity to receive it and hear from her this week in another meeting with her and her team. So thank you to Mayor Belil for her ongoing collaboration with the NCC.
First item on the agenda,
we're going to ask Alain to come forward. Alain, you will be presenting the federal land use and design approval, energy services acquisition program, modernized Gatineau Energy Center, final developed design.
So, Alain, c'est la parole est la vôtre.
So over to you, Alain. Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. Hello, Mr. Mayor, members of the board. We present to you this morning the Energy Services Acquisition Program, ESAP in English, which is a program designed to modernize the energy system of Public Works and Government Services Canada, which heats and cools many buildings in the federal precinct. This is the fourth major step of ESAP. It is a neighbor of the National Printing Facility, and it will replace the existing district energy system facility in Gatineau and it will be built on top of the current building and will include a green roof. The this will be a public-private partnership, and we'll be working with several private sector partners.
Il affirme l'ingénieur WSP Canada. Alors, le but de la présentation est d'obtenir l'approbation.
So the point of this presentation is to receive approval. Once the approval has been achieved, following, of course, the presentation in October, I'm going to hand things over to Mr. Meek, who will continue with the presentation.
As I mentioned, the purpose of the submission is to obtain federal land use and design approval for the developed design of the modernized Gatineau Energy Center, a component of Public Services and Procurement Canada's Energy Services Acquisition Program, or ESAP. I'll now provide a brief overview of the project's context and background. As Alain mentioned, the modernized Gatineau Energy Center is the fourth major ESAP component being presented to the Board of Directors for approval. The final developed designs for the Cliff Plant, the Tunney's Pasture Plant, and the River Pump Station were presented for the Board of Directors' approval in June 2021. As part of ESAP's modernization of the district energy system, the plants, as well as the water intakes at the River Pump Station and Cliff Plant, are to be interconnected through a significant expansion of the underground pipe distribution network. The distribution network consists of low-temperature hot water and chilled water supply and return lines. The distribution piping supports the climate control systems of 80 federal buildings in the National Capital Region. The site of the proposed modernized Gatineau Energy Center is located within the capital's core area in the Hull sector of the Ville de Gatineau. The core area boundary is shown in yellow on this slide. The site has been occupied by a surface parking lot previously. The modernized Gatineau Energy Center's site boundaries are identified in the dashed white lines and have the civic address of 83 Boulevard Sacré-Cœur. The site, as well as the adjacent National Printing Bureau lands, are under the ownership of Public Services and Procurement Canada. The National Printing Bureau complex at 45 Boulevard Sacré-Cœur to the west is a significant federal employment site that's primarily occupied by National Defense. An existing central heating plant is located behind the main National Printing Bureau building. The modernized Gatineau Energy Center will replace the existing plant. And a separate project is being planned that will rehabilitate the National Printing Bureau and involves a phased redevelopment of the lands behind the principal building. The new energy center's site is bounded to the south by existing residential and institutional land uses, including an apartment building, a cégep school, a church, and a building providing social services. A community garden is also present on the site of the cégep. Highway 5, l'autoroute de la Gatineau, is located along the northern edge of the site. Highway 5 is designated a capital arrival in the NCC's plans. The highway connects to the McDonald-Cartier Interprovincial Bridge, which is located about 1 kilometer east of the site. This slide illustrates the proposed redevelopment of the lands behind the National Printing Bureau's principal building. The plan was last presented to the Board of Directors in January of this year. The project teams for both the National Printing Bureau and the modernized Gatineau Energy Center have been working together closely to ensure pedestrian connectivity is maintained and strengthened for both the near term prior to the redevelopment and longer term as the phased development occurs. I've used the arrows on this slide to highlight locations identified for the ultimate pedestrian connections between the Energy Center and the Printing Bureau sites once redevelopment has occurred. In the interim, pedestrian connectivity to the Printing Bureau and the entrance pavilion of the Energy Center will be maintained. The proposed modernized Gatineau Energy Center's developed design carries forward the approved schematic design concept and provides additional detail, but with limited change. Above-grade components of the Energy Center remain limited to the Energy Pavilion building, an arrival plaza, a loading ramp, as well as emergency egress from the plant building. The floor accommodating the center's mechanical and electrical systems remains concealed below grade and is capped with a green roof. This has created a significant placemaking opportunity. Most of the site will provide a publicly accessible green space with over 200 trees proposed in an undulating meadow landscape featuring curvilinear walking trails. The landscape design is intended to contribute positively to the public realm and enhance views along the adjacent capital arrival route. Stormwater management will be addressed through landscaped bioswales located along the site boundaries. The site generally drains toward the north. The developed design submission has revised the walking trails to improve accessibility by using a hard surface and increasing their width to 1.5 meters. Additional detail provided in the developed design submission includes the specification of the planting lists and locations. The tree plantings include native species such as sugar and red maples, oaks, crabapple, spruce, and white pine trees. The arrangement of the trees will provide glimpses towards the Energy Center's pavilion from the adjacent Capitol arrival route. This slide provides an updated rendering of the entrance pavilion. The exterior architectural massing and material selections remain largely consistent with the schematic design submission and includes large format panels of light and dark colored porcelain, charcoal colored metal panels, and a glazed atrium with a frit pattern to protect against bird strikes. Additional details have also been provided regarding the exterior lighting at the entrance pavilion. The entrance pavilion's hard surfaces include concrete pavers inset with stone pavers in a pattern that will evoke the linear form of the entrance pavilion building. The project team is also now looking at options to minimize the use of the standard bollards that are shown on this slide that delineate the vehicular circulation routes and the pedestrian space of the plaza in favor of a solution more integrated with the site's design, such as raised planters. This slide provides some additional renderings and views of the entrance pavilion. The entrance plaza features several raised planters with integrated seating. This will offer a more formal urban approach to the landscape design on this part of the site. The entrance pavilion provides access to a reception area, as well as amenities such as a lunchroom and a universal washroom. This space will feature an exposed wood glue lamp structure and an expansive glazing providing views to the formal gardens. One level below, office and meeting spaces are provided, and glazing provided on the western elevation of the entrance pavilion will serve to provide as a light well down to the plant's mechanical systems floor. This slide provides three cross-sections of the new energy center, illustrating how the above-grade components have been integrated into the landscape. The first image at the top illustrates the south elevation that transects the lower plant floor, showing how it will be capped with a green roof. The middle image shows the elevation of the center as it would be seen from Highway 5. And finally, the lower image illustrates the undulating grading proposed for the metal landscape. This cross-section cuts from the north to the south through the entrance pavilion of the new energy center. The modernized Gatineau Energy Center will be powered by electricity supplied by Hydro-Québec's grid. Close to 100% of the electricity distributed by Hydro-Québec is generated from renewable sources. The substation is located to the southeast of the modernized Gatineau Energy Center, between the Cégep School and Boulevard Maisonneuve. The substation will be fed by an underground connection to the power grid. The equipment will be screened by an acoustic barrier, and the project team has proposed the incorporation of additional plantings to be confirmed with the submission of the revised final landscape plans for the substation. This project was presented to ACPADAR in August of last year, and the developed design has responded to many of the comments provided by ACPADAR and NCC staff. ACPADAR's comments emphasized the importance of successful integration and connectivity between the Energy Center and the neighboring properties. This would help ensure that the new green space is well used by the surrounding community. The developed design is responsive to other ACPADAR comments, including the integration of site lighting, the materiality of the curvilinear pathways, and the project team has continued to integrate Indigenous design input into the landscape design, as well as looked at opportunities to integrate interior and exterior artwork as part of the project. Construction on the site began in early 2023, following the approval of the delegated early works, which include site preparation, site servicing, and excavation. Approval for the early work scope was granted by the NCC in December 2022. The project is well aligned with the NCC's plans, including the plan for Canada's capital and Canada's capital core area sector plan. The proposed land use is consistent with the site's land use designation, and the landscape design will contribute to the scenic quality of the adjacent capital arrival route. The modernization of the district energy system through ESAP will result in reduced carbon pollution and will support the commitments made as part of the federal initiatives listed on this slide, including the Federal Sustainable Development Strategy. The Energy Center itself has been developed with sustainability in mind, and it has been designed to achieve LEED New Construction Gold certification. On to next steps. Staff are largely satisfied with the developed design submission and have identified a few minor items requiring further resolution. These are intended to be resolved in advance of the issuance of the required federal approval document authorizing the works. These items include the submission of final design drawings. In particular, the next submission will include the 99% submission for the substation site, and this will include more details regarding the landscape design for the substation, as well as additional tree plantings necessary to achieve the final tree compensation objectives. Staff have also been working with the project team to introduce a few rest areas along the curvilinear walking pathways away from the entrance pavilion, and this has been done in order to improve accessibility and provide visitors an opportunity to take more time to enjoy the site. Finally, the Modernized Gatineau Energy Center project team has committed to continued engagement with the National Printing Bureau project team, as well as other neighboring property owners, to pursue and implement all opportunities to add additional connections intended to further encourage public use of this newly introduced green space within the urban fabric. Staff are confident that these items will be successfully addressed based on our ongoing collaboration with the Energy Center's project team and the private partner. And with that, based on a review of the developed design submission for the Modernized Gatineau Energy Center, NCC staff are prepared to recommend approval subject to the conditions listed on this slide. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Chris. Merci, Alain, Isabelle. So as we, and from Mayor Sutcliffe, as we started as a practice during COVID, as opposed to we go around the table, and it's an opportunity for every member to have their voice heard, as opposed to just having hand-raising features. So we will do or continue that practice and start on the left side with Deborah.
Thank you very much for the presentation. I'm really excited about the plans for additional green space in the area. I have no further comments.
Thank you. And again, a reminder, if you don't have a comment, free to just pass. Madame Appadon.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Merci pour la...
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. Thank you for the presentation. It makes me more and more confident that we will truly advance with certainty towards a gold LEED certification, which we have always targeted. So thank you. And I see that what is left to be done is fairly light. We're talking about some landscaping elements. And I'm also confident that the timeline will be respected, so I propose that we accept this next stage that you are recommending we approve. Thank you very much. So there is a motion proposed by our colleague.
Report, so I'll be supporting it. Just as a side comment, you know, where we have things like these conditions state, that are important to the project, I think it's a best practice to sort of ask the proponent to make those changes before we approve it, because our ability to enforce conditions after the fact is maybe dubious at best on some days. And not to say that people won't honor their word if they're agreed to those conditions, but if they're that important to us, I think it's something we should be asking for those revisions to happen before we approve it to be certain. Just that's my bias, where the things are important. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Michael. Victor.
Has the proposal already been seconded? Okay, then I will second the motion. I'm representing the other side of the river, so I'm happy to see these important developments taking place on the Quebec side of the capital region. And I see the logic, given that we are going to use Hydro-Quebec's grid, which long-term will probably be more sustainable and less expensive than in Ontario. So if we have a choice as to where to place our infrastructure, I I think it is the right choice to do it there. But I would like to better understand. I approve entirely the design and the use of the land, but I would like to understand better the distribution of energy. If I'm understanding correctly, this plan will produce energy from taking electricity and using liquids. Is that, are we talking about water? And where is that water going? Is it going to the pumping station? And from the pumping station, it's going to 90 different buildings, including passing through Cliff Plant. Is there a direct connection with the Cliff Plant? That's one question. And my other question is, what is the route for this energy before it comes back to this facility?
Well, I'll just respond in English for clarity.
Oh, yeah, that's fine. That's fair. Thank you.
The intent is to interconnect and build resilience through connecting the multiple plants in the system. The National Printing Bureau plant has a distribution system that is connected across the McDonald Cartier Bridge over to the Cove plant, which is also connected to the Tunney's Pasture plant. And the idea is that, you know, it increases the system's resilience. One of the questions was whether it's water. My understanding is it's low-temperature water and chilled water. The purpose of the plant itself is to provide heating and cooling services to buildings. The system, as it stands today, serves 80 federal buildings for heating and 67 for cooling. Beyond the initial project to modernize the district energy system by 2025, they're also exploring opportunities for future expansion. I don't know if I've missed anything in the question. Do you have anything you wanted to add?
No, I think it's just low temperature and low pressure water. And and there's the potential expansion to up to 800 buildings, but that's not in the phase that we're at today.
Mais le système globalement.
But the system generally, there will be several stages of transfer of energy, whether that be electricity to water, this low-temperature water, or from Cliff Plant, natural gas to possibly those same materials, liquids, water that will circulate through the system. We talked about in other projects, Le Breton, where we would have energy, community or district energy. Will Le Breton be connected to this overall system?
The initial system expansion doesn't include the new connections, but that could be explored after 2025 in this first phase of the ESAP project.
Et il y a des opportunités éventuelles de rajouter des.
Yes, and there are opportunities to add new renewable energies if we move towards geothermal, for example, or the use of biomass, because there are already users of biomass. Pulp and paper, the pulp and paper industry is already using these biomass energies. Are we thinking about the possibility of bringing online other sustainable energies that can join this jigsaw puzzle later? The puzzle is so huge that for your average citizen, it's hard to understand. We can accept and anticipate that we might be making the right decisions now in 2023, but we also need to anticipate what's going to happen in the future, and we trust you to do so. Thank you, Victor. Liz? Yes, a very interesting project for the environment, that's all. Denis, no comment, just to say that the comments of the committee were incorporated, and that was really important to see.
Thank you, Lisa. Hello.
I'm done.
Caroline.
Oui, alors...
Yes, evidently I support this project. It's an opportunity, an excellent opportunity both for technical improvements, but also creation of a public space. So it's exemplary in that regard. Secondly, all of the comments that have been that have come from the committee from Ecuador have been included, and I think. It's an important project because it is neighboring a heritage building, and so the treatment, the way the approach was important, and I think this was done in a rigorous fashion to respect to that heritage aspect. Norm.
For being aesthetically pleasing to look at usually, so I appreciate the design with the green space and the walking paths in it.
Miigwech. Larry.
Thank you. I think it's worth noting that if this project had been done 15 years ago, we would see a utility building there. We would see no thinking about public amenity. We would see no landscape, especially adjacent to a highway. There would have been very little attention to other aspects that create a great city. So to me, this is a very important project, not only for the system here, but literally as a model for our country, to take these kind of utility investments and get double duty out of them as public amenities. We're turning a parking lot into a park. That's not been talked about. It's important if you're in that community that all of a sudden your open space access is way wider than it used to be. So to me, that's very, very important. The second thing very important to me is that this is exemplary design. This could have been utilitarian design, but it isn't. This could meet any standard anywhere in the nation or in the world. And that's what I've always wanted our capital to be, is the place where you show projects like this as a different way to build cities. And so I highly support this and believe it sets a standard for all the utilities in the capital from now on. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Larry. Mayor Sutcliffe. Thank you. So the motion was moved by Deborah and seconded by Victor, by Madame Apparon. And seconded by Victor. All in favor? Great. Thank you very much. Merci, Alain, Isabelle, Chris.
Thank you, Alain, Isabelle, and Chris. Donc, poursuivons maintenant avec la mise à jour sur les plaines Le Breton. Je demanderai à Leonard de se joindre à nous.
Building Le Breton project. This project is multifaceted, with many components working together to bring the bigger picture to life. Today's presentation will give you some insight into the initiatives currently underway to support the various aspects of the Building Le Breton project. Our Chief of Planning Engagement, Laura Mueller, will be giving the presentation this morning.
Thank you, Bill. Good morning, Chair and members of the Board. I'm pleased to be back again to give you an update on the various initiatives we have underway as part of the Building Le Breton project. So this presentation is for your information, and it will give you a sense of the progress we're making on the development phases and other projects that we have underway, as Bill said, to bring this project to life. First, I can provide a brief update on the Major Event Center project. We continue to meet regularly with Capital Sports Development Inc., or CSDI, as they advance their due diligence and design process while the sale of the Ottawa Senators hockey team is underway in parallel. At the request of CSDI, the NCC has met with a number of the groups that are vying to purchase the team, and this dialogue will support a smooth transition and working relationship with the new owners. The team sale process is expected to proceed over the coming couple of months, and we will continue to aim to sign a lease for the site in the fall while maintaining a collaborative approach to support the project through the team's ownership transition. On to our latest offering, which is the flats phase. The deadline for submissions under the request for offers to lease was October 5th of last year. And following the evaluation process, we are now conducting commercially confidential meetings to secure a preferred proponent with whom to enter into negotiations for a lease that could include between the 2 and 4 parcels that you see highlighted on the slide. We're hopeful that we will be in a position to announce a successful proponent in the coming months, and execution of a lease agreement is targeted for late 2023. The regular municipal development application process, including zoning and site plan control, would follow. Moving on to the first development phase of our project, which is the library parcel. Dream LeBreton, which is the successful proponent that purchased the site at 665 Albert Street, is making good progress. In October, City Council approved amendments to the official plan and zoning bylaw needed in order to implement the project. And the project is currently going through the NCC's design approval process. Schematic design approval was recently issued, and the next step is to work on the developed design submission. Dream also recently secured approval from the City of Ottawa to enable it to connect a wastewater energy transfer system to the city's sewer infrastructure. And this will enable Dream to capture thermal energy from wastewater for the provision of low-carbon heating and cooling for the development. This will be the first such sustainable energy system in Ottawa and will support the Building LeBreton Project's zero-carbon sustainability strategy. Dream is also working on their municipal site plan control application and hopes to have shovels in the ground this year. In terms of other work to support development readiness, we're preparing for the next phase of archaeological assessment of the Malik House site, which is within the Albert District. We conducted archaeological impact assessment in the fall, which identified artifacts predating the Great Fire of 1900, and the report recommended further investigation of the Malik House be undertaken. In preparation for more intensive archaeological excavation this summer, a number of trees were removed from the site prior to bird nesting season, and those trees will be compensated for with plantings in the LeBreton area in the future. A more substantial archaeological mitigation dig will take place this summer, and any artifacts that are discovered will be retained and potentially could be displayed or incorporated into LeBreton Flats in the future. Another planning note, I had mentioned at our last update that we will be hiring a planning and engineering firm to undertake a plan of subdivision for LeBreton Flats to support development readiness. And our request for proposals closed in February, and we plan to secure a consultant and begin work in the coming weeks. The municipal subdivision process will include creating a framework for the infrastructure that needs to be delivered with each development block. And we will also work with the consultant to advance the innovative street design that is proposed in the master concept plan, which anticipates streets designed for pedestrian and cyclist priority, similar to the Dutch Woonerf style of street. The subdivision is expected to take approximately 2 years and will incur in parallel to the Flats and Major Event Center phases. And public consultations will occur through the municipal development application process. Shifting gears, we're also working in parallel to advance sustainability planning for LeBreton Flats. As you know, fostering sustainability and innovation is a guiding principle of the Master Concept Plan. And in order to deliver on the plan's zero carbon mandate, we commissioned a community energy plan, which contains two key recommendations. First, that buildings developed within LeBreton Flats should meet or exceed Canada Green Building Council's zero carbon building design and performance standards. And second, that the NCC should develop a district energy system to generate and distribute net zero carbon energy for heating and cooling within LeBreton Flats. We're currently working to obtain technical expertise in district energy systems in order to drive this process forward to determine the system specifications. And we will also be evaluating procurement options to secure an operator for a future district energy system at LeBreton Flats. And finally, we're also embarking on further planning for Parks and Public Realm, which is one of the most exciting components of the Building LeBreton Project. Over the course of the project, we'll be developing 43% of the Master Concept Plan area as Parks and Public Realm. We're aiming to continuously improve the public realm at LeBreton Flats over the course of the project to ensure public benefits are made available alongside development. Last year, construction was fully completed on the new LeBreton Flats pathway, which introduced approximately 1 kilometer of new multi-use pathways and segregated pathways, connecting the existing Trillium pathway and Capital pathway along the Ottawa River with the two O-train stations in LeBreton Flats. Already in the pathway's first 16 months of operations, the number of people using it is impressive. An average of 8,000 trips per month were made in 2022. And while the summer months saw the heaviest use, there's year-round traffic on the pathway thanks to the Kitchissibi Winter Trail, which provides a groomed trail for cross-country skiing and winter activity. Building on the early success of the pathway, this summer we're planning to roll out additional amenities for the public in the area west of the Pimisi O-Train station. The improvements will include seating and shaded spots to enjoy the O-Train passing by, among other fun features similar to the types of things you can see on the slide that are inspiring us. So please stay tuned on this for more information as summer approaches. So as you can see, there are many aspects of the Building LeBreton project underway simultaneously in line with our commitment to our guiding principle to make it happen. And we will continue to provide updates on these various initiatives. And I welcome any questions or comments you may have.
Thank you very much, Laura. And I love that last comment around make it happen. It was certainly a board's mandate when it's only been a couple of years since we relaunched this process. And what's exciting for, I think, all Canadians and certainly local citizens is it's no longer just a brownfield. It's no longer just talk. It's no longer just plans. We have three phases already underway with this incredible development. We have parks and pathways going through the public realm, which is going to, like you said, and comprise of approximately 40% of the site. Hundreds of housing units that have been procured through these first few phases, including hundreds and hundreds of affordable housing units. The site's coming to life. We have a new public library with the archives that is going to be a centerpiece there as well. We have the two LRT stations. As I leave my role after 6 years, it's an exciting chapter for the National Capital Region to see this project after how many years of being dormant is, like we said, no longer talk. It is in full swing and momentum. So thank you for taking that make it happen so seriously and moving the project along. And it's just a matter of time before we see people living, playing, residing, working in the Flats District, in the LeBreton Flats. So thank you very much for the leadership from Bill, Katie, and Laura. So we'll turn it over to questions. We'll start this side with Mayor Sutcliffe.
Thank you for the presentation. I just wondered if you could give a quick high-level sense of the timetable of when different things will be completed. And I know that's subject to change, but just to have a sense of how it'll roll out over the coming years.
So with the library parcel, which is the first phase, I think construction is scheduled for 3 years. So that would be 2026 if they're in the ground this year. So we expect to see people living at the site relatively soon. For the flats phase, like we said, we're aiming for a lease by the end of this year. And to be honest, we don't have a full design, so we need to see that full design before we'd be able to estimate timelines to build. But it's at least 1 million square feet, well, around 1 million square feet, so it's larger than the library parcel, and I just don't want to speculate about how many years that's going to take to deliver. And the major event center, of course, if a lease is in place at the end of this year, again, design all of the different elements involved. I just think that it wouldn't be right to speculate on exactly when it's going to be delivered. There are arenas that are built within 3 years, 4 years, so it would be an estimate. But
Katie, you can expand on the parks and the pathways and the public realm.
Right, so we're in design on, we're moving towards parkland design, and we'll be, of course, using a phasing strategy to deliver the parks as well. We're working with the City of Ottawa on a recreational park at the site, we'll be advancing the design next year. And again, we'll be implementing that incrementally.
Thank you, Katie. Thank you, Mayor Sutcliffe. Larry.
Thank you. I have a question and then a comment. Could you just remind us of the affordability pattern in the library parcel?
Sure. So I think there are around 250 units, 247 may be the more precise number. And half of those are going to be delivered at 79% of the average median income. And the other half at 69%. So I'm just going to pause for my team. 59. Yeah, so yeah, I think it was 80 and 60 roughly. So, and part of those are going to be owned by Dream, and part of them are going to be owned by Multifaith Housing Initiative. And all will be rental.
And that leads, Mr. Chair, to my comment, which is having been involved across the country in a number of these very large projects, very seldom does a city get the opportunity to have a big part of your city close to your downtown redeveloped. And be able to have the public objectives guide that. Most often, that is in private hands, and while there is collaboration usually with the municipality, the drive is to achieve the private objectives. In this case, what I think is extraordinary for the capital is that the drive is to achieve the public objectives. And the proof of that is in just this first housing project. The first housing project in most projects like this is meant to yield cash. It's meant to yield profit to carry forward into the future. In this case, while we're mindful of that economic objective, we did not say we would defer the social objective. And we know in this city, as across the whole country, this issue of affordability is right at the top of almost every citizen's thinking and worry. And so I think this is a very important thing. And I believe it's important also for what a citizen of Ottawa, or I would say a citizen of Vancouver, where I'm from, should expect from this project every step of the way. That balance between the private objective to achieve profitability and a good economic model for the capital, which, by the way, will stay in the hands of the people of Canada and the people of Ottawa as a long-term lease thing, and achieving these public objectives. This is how a city redefines itself, and either that redefinition is in the image of the private sector's needs or in the image of the public sector's needs, rarely. And in this case, it is that, but balancing both. I just think this is an amazing project, and really we should all think about where we were 2 years ago when we were worried, people of Ottawa were worried, what kind of development's going to happen? And I'll notice that the event center is still included. So it's not like we gave that up in order to achieve this. We're getting both. So it's this is a project that will be an exemplar across the country, and as it should be. So I'm very supportive of what they're doing. I have to say, having been in their shoes in many occasions in the past years, the achievement of this much, this fast, at the staff level is exemplary. It's just unbelievable, and I commend you as a staff for that, your staff team. Throughout the last few years, every time we've raised an issue, instead of a rebut, we've seen an embrace. And that's really where the leadership and the organization has really come together. It's really been amazing. And so I take it away as an example that will inspire my work and should inspire all of our work. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Larry. Caroline.
Pour ajouter à ce que Larry...
Just to add on what Larry mentioned, I think it's an exemplary project in terms of landscaping. So all of the different phases and the implementation phase and the landscaping phase is exemplary, and that's what pushed forward all of the architecture projects. So from an architectural point of view, there's a lot of rigor. It's a rigor that is going to mark the capital, but that's going to be that also is going to be close to the citizens. And I want to commend you for that, because you don't give up, and it's this element, and it's very important. Thank you, Caroline.
Colleagues here. Thank you, Lou. Lisa.
I'm kind of in the same position as Lou. I mean, we lean on Larry and Carolyn's expertise, but Katie, you and your team have done an exceptional role at embracing what the boards really wanted to see happen, and this is a transforming project for the city. Thank you.
Thank you, Lisa. Denis?
Je ferai pas de commentaires techniques.
No technical comments, because my colleagues are very good at that. I'm the one who was always asking the question, when are we going to put the shovel on the ground, the boots on the ground? And my question is a practical question. We're developing public spaces. And between now and the major construction, whether it's the major event center or the buildings, people will get used to the public spaces. Are we going to remove access to public spaces during the construction phase? Because we are creating habits. We're talking about 8,000 people, and this summer there will be more. But at some point, there's going to be machines in construction. Are we going to have, like we do it in the West, I forgot the name, Westboro, we had to close the place for the summer. Are we going to be to have to do that in the different phases of the project?
Remain open. I think in most NCC projects, we strive to keep pathways open. We strive to maintain access. It's a big site. So even if there's construction on part of the site, largely we'll be able to maintain that kind of access. And of course, would need to close for construction directly on a site. But otherwise, we'll strive to maintain that.
Thank you. Merci.
Merci, Denis. Thank you, Katie. Lise.
C'est un projet unique.
This is a unique project for Ottawa. It's absolutely extraordinary, and I lift my hat to the staff and to ourselves. Thank you. Victor. I want to go back on the question of energy optimization, as we saw in the previous presentation, considering that this project is at the core of the capital and it's within all of the energy grid that was in the previous project. We understand that for phase one, we are going to get the energy from underground waters, the gray waters, and we are going to remove a few degrees, and we will use that to heat the buildings. Does it include all of phase one, so the library, residential buildings, and the major event center?
The library itself, I believe, will be connected to ESAP. I believe that is still the case. And that isn't our project, right? So that's separate. The library parcel is going to be heated and cooled by the thermal energy within the sewer, right? So there's the heat exchange, and that does both heating and cooling within that precinct. That may end up becoming a bit of a node for other properties surrounding it. But the bigger picture is a district system for the rest of the site. When we go forward with an RFP for that district energy system, it may be that ESAP is the best system suited to serve the site. And it may be that another nearby district energy system would also be good. But I think what we have to do is keep our eyes on what's going to be effective for the marketplace, right? So to make sure that there's a good business case for the pricing of the energy that's provided. So there's going to be a bit of a balancing act in terms of what is going to be the best solution for the site.
Donc, je comprends bien que pour la phase 1,
so I understand that for phase one, we rely mainly on used waters, energy. And for the future development, we're going to think about it. We have choices to make. We can go towards geothermics, possibly. I know that ZB, the neighbor, is also using biomass energy from Kruger's. And Havik will be a more an increased production from these partners in the future. I'm thinking, for instance, of biomass or the electricity from Quebec or Ontario. I don't know.
I think that the reality is, for for a site of our size, there's no silver bullet. There's no one thing that is going to be the energy source. We have the Ottawa River flowing by. That's a great cooling source. There could be geothermal. There could be heat exchange. There could be seasonal storage. There could be a lot of different tools to provide the energy for the site within this district. And I think those different strategies are going to be necessary to be able to be a net zero system for the entire site. And if there's an interprovincial strategy, if there's a strategy that does hook it up to a different district in the area, that will come out during the process of seeking the best solution. That's what we were, that's what we're driven by.
Je vous félicite pour,
I commend you for reaching the zero carbon footprint energy in phase one. And I trust that we're going to make an effort to minimize the carbon footprint throughout all of the other phases with the competition that exists between the various ways to supply these sites with energy. Thank you. Thank you, Victor. Michael.
I hope you'll be patient with me. I have a few remarks to make, and I'm a little bit philosophical given that it's your last meeting, and I think for a lot of us, we're getting nearer to the end of our 10 years than the beginning, certainly. So I have some perspective on this, because I think when history looks back upon the Seaman years at the NCC, I think LeBreton Flats is going to be the number one bullet point people think about. So for the big picture I'm thinking about is how 60 years ago, this lands were expropriated, and they were, for the most part, left empty. A few little things happened once in a while, but it was a black eye. It has been a black eye on downtown Ottawa for a very long time, and through many different governments and many different eras, and good times and bad times. It just didn't seem like, again, not for want of ambition or want of, you know, maybe the resources or many different things that could be used as an excuse. Nothing happened for a very long time until the Seaman years, until we came to this latest point, and no one can doubt now that something is happening, and it's finally we are beginning to turn the corner, and we have turned the corner on that history, and not for nothing. You know, when I joined the board, I remember being warned about this red hot controversy that was LeBreton Flats, and how you were going to be into the middle of this red hot controversy. And fast forward here, 5.5-6 years later, and the good news from Katie and Bill and their team, it's almost becoming boring how much good news we get. You know, like we have we have to keep, you know, it's the opposite of controversial. It's something that, I mean, I can't help but observe how, you know, I was warned that everyone had an opinion about the LeBreton Flats, and the only thing everyone could agree on is the NCC was doing everything wrong. Fast forward is some years, and I know in the recent mayoral election, for example, as I read what the various candidates were saying, there was a consensus that, you know what, things are sort of on the right track in LeBreton, more or less. And when you can go from everyone could only agree the NCC was doing everything wrong to everyone agrees that it's generally on the right track. That is a long and impressive journey. In a relatively short time, though. And I think this board in general, and you in particular, and Toby and Mark deserve a huge amount. And obviously, Katie and Bill and the rest of their team absolutely deserve credit for that. And it's one shame, I think, is that we do a lot of talking about this in camera. There have been so many twists and turns and different aspects of this that we've agonized over. Just thinking about the public presentations we've had, I wish the public would know. I wish history would know just how good a deal this is for the public. I'm not sure it's possible for the public to know just how good a deal it is, because when you look at just the financial benefit that will ultimately accrue to the public purse as a result of this, it is so much better than every other scenario we thought about, to the tune of, I don't think I'm disclosing anything confidential, say hundreds of millions of dollars is the trajectory of this thing, which is just going to be improving the capital and again, improving the public finances for years to come and for all the good things I can't even imagine that the NCC and government in general is going to do with that money. And as a capital planner, which has been the NCC's mandate for a long time, here we are. I think we are in a golden age of capital planning with LeBreton Flats. This is a high watermark for NCC capital planning, something that had been tentative about. It's embracing fully, you know, it's doing its own planning applications, master planning on as Larry said, on a very impressive scale globally. So it's a high watermark for the NCC in that regard as well. And when I think and it bears mentioning for not in the capital planning vein, you know, the public spaces we're going to get, the aqueduct, you know, these are going to be iconic Ottawa places that you know, everyone will have to go to Ottawa. You have to, in this winter, you have to skate down the Rideau Canal. You're going to have to kayak down the aqueduct. That's going to be a thing that you have to do in Ottawa, right? And the major capital park, this is going to be an iconic capital park. And so these are things that I don't think everyone has totally taken on board yet about just how cool and exciting those things are. And then coming back to my point about the expropriation, you know, I think we have sort of unintentionally, you know, kind of vindicated some of that bad history, that black eye, and how good this is going to turn out. I think people are going to look back and say, dare I say, it was worth the wait for something that good. Like, at least they got it right when they finally did something. I think that's where we're headed with this. And so that does, I think, in some way vindicate sort of the bad history that we inherited and sort of turns the corner on that. I'll close with sort of one more philosophical remark. And you know, some of us have been talking in the past about homes we grew up in and homes we lived, and we all have a house or a house that's precious to us. You know, it's easy to forget that there are going to be thousands of people living in Le Breton flats. Well, right now there's nothing. For 6 years, there's going to be thousands of homes, affordable homes in many cases. This is where people are going to have their first home. People are going to live. They're going to love. They're going to raise their children, right? They're going to grow old there, and all the other, and they're going to fall in love with those homes we're creating, and you know, the same way we all love a home in our own life, right? And we don't know those people, and they'll probably never know our names, know your name, Mark and Toby, but or Katie and Bill, but those homes will exist because of the work we did around this table, and that's just an amazing thing to think that we had a hand in creating that sort of piece. It'll be a piece of the heart of Ottawa. It's really impressive, and I think I might even live to see the day when out there in Le Breton Flats, where there is a conspicuous rock out there right now, I think I might live to see the day when there is some young person gets to raise the Stanley Cup above his head on that spot on Le Breton Flats, and you know, that's a day which the people in this room will know that that person's doing that there in a small part because of some of the work we've done here today. And it's really inspiring. So thank you, Mark, for your leadership in particular. And we wouldn't have enough time for all the thank yous. And there is a lot of important work still to come. You know, there's some important things to keep the eye on the prize. But again, in this kind of philosophical mode we're in your last meeting, it bears mentioning sort of where this started and where we're at and where we're going with it. So thank you for the chance to be a part of it. So, yeah. The Leafs will be raising it before then. The Leafs will be raising it much sooner, just for the record.
Hey, thank you, Michael. Thank you for the kind words and sort of the one of the points that Michael raises around the money that's generated and what's great about the board's decision a number of years ago when we went through this process is that all the money's generated from Le Breton will go back into Le Breton. So the money's generated from this library parcel, as an example, helped build the park that's going to happen in the public realm. So just want to clarify that while this is a, you know, the financial piece is an important one, it's all going back into Le Breton to building this in a fast track manner, in a proper manner, and in one that is financially sustainable and viable. So thank you for raising that, because it raises a great point around the financial piece of this.
And the equity stays with the people of Canada.
Yeah. Thank you. Madame Appelot.
Merci, Monsieur le Président.
Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you for the presentation once again. I don't say that you are surprising us. It's not a surprise anymore, but we remain very eager to know what you're going to tell us in terms of updates and progress that you're presenting us. This project seems like it's going to be an exemplary project. I hope that the rhythm will be maintained, that nothing will happen like a pandemic or some sort of catastrophe that will potentially slow down this project that really goes above and beyond expectations in terms of deadlines that we had before. So thank you very much. All I can say now is that the progress that we've made are above the expectations that we had we are very enthusiastic and we remain very happy about what's happening. Any parole?
I've bored this before because I get a little emotional about it. I'm doing it again. Shouldn't have said that. My grandfather gave up the family business that his grandfather built on the Breton Flats in the 60s. So this is kind of personal for me. I'm sorry. And, you know, we've been sitting there as a family, sort of, why did he do that? Why did he give up that? And not that he had a choice, but to be here at this point and to be a part of making sure that that was worthwhile has been such an honor for me. Oh, my goodness. I am so proud of the focus that this new plan has. I don't know that people sort of fully understand the scale and the scope of how exceptional it is, the commitment to the best practices to make sure this is the best example of how to have a sustainable development, the commitment to accessibility, not just in terms of making sure that it is an affordable place for families in center town to live, which is so important if you know anything about the history of the area where we're building, but also to make sure that it is a welcoming place for everybody else in the city and indeed everyone else in the country and the world through the public realms as spaces that we're creating. And again, because we're still in the stages of designing and planning it, I don't think people really have a sense of how much public space this is going to create and how many wonderful attractions that people are going to enjoy and be amazed about. I'm so excited about those possibilities. And, you know, my colleagues have spoken very eloquently about the fact that this is a legacy, because not only are we creating an entire new community that really reflects the best of what we want Canada to be today and going forward, but in the future, we will protect that for generations of Canadians to come. And so whatever the next iteration needs to be, we will still have control over that. So I am absolutely honored to have been part of this process and so amazed and thrilled with the speed in which, I know, Katie, I said so many times, how can this happen? How can this happen? How can it happen faster? And I'm okay now because it's only been 2 years. You've done so much, but it 100% has been worth waiting for.
Yes, thank you very much, Deborah, and thank you for sharing your personal family story and that connection. Really appreciate it. And as you've mentioned, again, thank you to the team. When we relaunched the Le Breton Flats, there were lessons learned, and there was best practices, and we made this a priority. We asked you to bring an update at every board meeting to make it a priority, and you've stayed with it. And as people have said, it's when you reflect, actually, and you pause, you realize it is a big part of history and how the city will be shaped going forward. So, and the national capital will be shaped. So thank you very much for the presentation and for the partnership, the collaboration. I will miss working with all of you, but appreciate all the work that's been done over the years. So thank you, Laura, Katie, and Bill. We will now move to our last item on the agenda. On va demander à Simon de revenir...
We're going to ask Simon, who is our new vice president, to come back. It's the first public presentation in person with Simon. So welcome. How long has it been? About 3 months. So congratulations. We're very happy to have you. It's very exciting. It's the first time that we're going to have an event on major projects. We see that we have a lot of investment by the government for our projects and the rehabilitation of the city, and we're going to have an update with the major event of the NCC. Thank you, welcome, and it's up to you.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Bonjour tout le monde. Good morning, all the board members and Mr. Mayor. Good morning. So we're thrilled to be here this morning to present some of our major projects. Since 2018, the NCC has received significant additional parliamentary appropriation, which enabled it to begin improving the condition of priority assets. Through the fall economic update, And budget 2022, the NCC will continue to see an increase in funding over the next 6 years to rehabilitate and maintain historically and culturally important assets. These significant investments will allow the NCC to address one of its most significant strategic risks, deferred asset maintenance. The following 8 major projects, totaling over $200 million in investments, are central to the Commission's multi-year program of work. Importantly, they not only serve to improve the condition of the assets, but they advance the NCC's vision of creating an inclusive, thriving, and connected national capital region. Now, to go through these projects in details, I introduce Bruno Fabien, a senior project manager, and Justin Nadeau, a project manager with the NCC. Justin, over to you.
The first project is the Westboro Beach redevelopment. As the key part of the Ottawa River South Shore Riverfront Park Plan, this project aims to create an accessible and vibrant destination that will enhance the quality of life of Capital residents and visitors. This site boasts outstanding views of the river, heritage and archaeological features, existing mature trees, and beach and waterfront activities. This project will open up these amenities to all users and enhance visitor experience with a focus on the following features: the rehabilitation and integration of the iconic James Strutt pavilions, a zero carbon park pavilion offering a restaurant and community space, the integration of the Skeed Mill ruins, children's play area, open picnic area, and volleyball courts, a variety of riverfront lookouts, and the removal of invasive species and creation of new habitat. There will be improved safety and accessibility throughout the site. This project is currently in construction, targeting a 2024 completion.
The second project is the rehabilitation of the Champlain Bridge. It's connecting Gatineau to Ottawa. It was built between 1924 and 1928 to respond to the increase of the population. This is used every day by thousands of vehicles, cyclists, and pedestrians. With a central means during rush hour, and it's a cycling way. This represents the values of the NCC for public transportation and active transportation. After many studies between 2018 and 2020, there were two major conclusions that were drawn. One is that the structure needs a major repairs, and two, that the safety of cyclists was in jeopardy. In August 2022, the NCC started some major work to repair the structure of the bridge and to increase the safety of cyclists that have been increasing in the National Capital Commission area. Work is still underway and will continue until November 2023. The third project is the Lac Philippe camping. This is based in the Gatineau Park. It was rehabilitated in 1950s and welcomes thousands of visitors. The aging buildings do not respond anymore to the expectations of visitors. In 2022, the NCC started the work of an important project that will modernize the buildings of the camping of Lac Philippe. This will give the opportunity to promote Gatineau Park and to encourage Canadians to visit nature and to increase the experience of visitors. This project includes the construction of a multifunctional pavilion at the side of the lake, the construction of a multi-service pavilion, the adding of a unit for camping, of kitchens, and the improvement of accessibility, and the improvement of different interpretation sites, and the recognition of the presence of First Nations in this area. The demolition work started in the fall 2022, and the project should be finished by the summer of 2024.
Is the Rideau Canal lighting system rehabilitation. The lighting system along the Rideau Canal corridor is classified as a UNESCO World Heritage Site. But over the past decade, the light fixtures and network have experienced significant deterioration as they are beyond their intended lifespan. The lighting along the Rideau Canal multi-use pathway is particularly inadequate, with some sections devoid of any illumination. This project will not only restore the existing lighting network, but will increase the total number of fixtures by 50% along the pathways and 5% along the roads in order to adhere to current safety standards. A public historian was consulted during the lighting selection process, and this collaborative process involved a diverse group of stakeholders, including Heritage, Park Canada, and the City of Ottawa. The Capital Illumination Plan has guided this design development, with the project set to begin in the summer of 2023.
The fifth project is Capitol Hill. When there was a flood in 2019, many parts of that area had certain. We launched this important rehabilitation project. One, to improve the resiliency of the site for future floods, and two, to increase the stability of the slopes. The walls will be built with stone and will have a natural look that will be harmonized with the environment. The design includes different heights of wall, different sizes of stone, and parts that will be hidden by different plants. This will be in link with the heritage designation. The NCC mobilized in March 2023 there was something in place in Wellington Street. This important project will end in the fall 2024.
Point, formerly known as Nepean Point, which is located on an outcrop of bedrock on the banks of the Ottawa River. This location offers stunning views of the capital's landmarks, including national institutions, commemorative monuments, and the Ottawa River. The design features a perimeter landscape ha-ha element that allows for unimpeded vistas and an incredible lookout and sheltered seating area. The park will be filled with places to gather, surrounded by native trees, flowering meadows with sculptures and art, making this a year-round destination for both residents and visitors, as it is set to become a focal point in the capital. The access to the park was essentially disconnected from the capital experience when the National Gallery of Canada was built in the late 1980s. This new pedestrian bridge will restore that connection through the installation of an elevated, multi-use pathway that will link Majors Hill Park with the newly developed Kiwiki Point. The bridge is being prefabricated off-site while the foundations are nearing completion on-site. At the apex of the site is the architectural feature known as Whispering Point. Visitors will experience the intimate sheltered seating nodes along the lower perimeter pathway and an elevated panoramic lookout on the top of the cantilever structure. Construction of the bridge and park is planned to be completed in late 2023 with the opening in early summer 2024. The seventh project is the rehabilitation of Lady Grey Drive Wall. Originally constructed in 1911, this 600-meter-long structure has been maintained for over 100 years. Detailed investigations and a geotechnical study have recommended the complete replacement of the wall. The removal and reconstruction of this wall is a formidable engineering challenge. This wall supports the Lady Grey Drive, which has been largely cut off from the surrounding area. The rebuilt wall will create the opportunity to transform this road into a pedestrian-friendly, multi-use promenade that can connect key nodes along the river. The eighth and final project is the NCC River House. Previously known as the Ottawa New Edinburgh Canoe Club, this is a historically significant building, and it was constructed in 1914 and 1925. It has been the site of canoeing, boating, and recreational activities for a century. The comprehensive building rehabilitation, completed in 2022, with a newly installed stairway, switchback path, and bridge, provide universal accessibility from the parkway to the boathouse. Ottawa Riverkeeper is now the major tenant of the River House, with a multi-year lease with ONIC in development. The ballroom has four events booked this summer, and a promising proposal by a food and beverage company is being reviewed. In conjunction with these efforts, the NCC undertook a landscape and shoreline animation project. It is designed to provide additional attractions and unique experiences. The new dock area is set to be completed this summer.
Donc en conclusion,
so in conclusion, these major projects play an important role in the animation of the National Capital Area to improve its portfolio. And this is a priority for the NCC, and this will meet the expectations of Canadians. All these investments are done to correct the maintenance, but also with the intention to improve the use of our common spaces. The intention of the NCC is to have a positive impact on the different experience of the present and future generations by advancing the vision of an area of the National Capital Area that is more inclusive, prosper, and connected. So I would like to take this opportunity to thank Bruno and Justin for their great work.
Very hard to this point, and we'll continue to do so to deliver on all these projects. So at this point, we'll be happy to take some questions and some comments. Thank you.
Merci beaucoup, Simon, Bruno, et Justin.
Thank you, Simon, Bruno, and Justin.
Very, very big projects, but they're transformational projects. All of them are designed to bring access to the public to our sites, to enhance the waterfronts, to provide opportunities for citizens, visitors, to experience the national capital in a tremendous way. So thank you for the leadership, and it's been part of the vision of the board as we got, you know, to bring the NCC's numerous assets back to life, not just for the sake of rehabilitation, but for the sake of public access and public use. So thank you very much for taking all those guiding principles. And it's an exciting time to be a citizen in this National Capital Region. With that, we're going to start on my left with Lisa.
Watching and looking at all of these projects develop and then seeing them where they are today, it's incredible. Because many people have said it, they're transformational projects. I'd be remiss if I didn't talk about how lucky our communities within the National Capital are to have the NCC. Many of these projects, whether they're built by cities, they're very difficult to maintain on just tax dollars, property tax dollars. So how fortunate that the Capital Region has the NCC, because a municipality would never be able to really reinvigorate and revitalize these public amenities to the level that we see here. They're legacy pieces that will create opportunities for tourism to this region, which is obviously a huge economic benefit for the businesses here. But just so lucky. I wish there was an NCC right across this country, because most municipalities just couldn't even dream that these types of initiatives would be undertaken. So well done.
Thank you, Lisa, and I know you're doing a tremendous job with your own municipality in Nova Scotia. I appreciate your comments. Thank you very much. Denis?
Merci, Monsieur le Président.
Thank you for this excellent update. We even played with Bibio today. So I am happy to see, among others, because I'm looking at the 8 projects that were presented, we see the issue of accessibility while we're doing the work. So the Kiwiki point that we're expecting for next year. But what makes me especially happy, because I was there from the beginning, and some people said that it's interesting to see how projects begin and end. So we'll be able to see the site in the east of the city that will open most likely this summer. And I hope that we will be able to see all this. But I think there's a richness there, and I think that the people who will live in Westboro will go to the east of the city to enjoy that. These are very nice projects, beautiful, actually. And I think that most of us will see the end of this project and we'll be able to enjoy it. So thank you to your team, and thank you for your presentation. Thank you, Denis. Leeds, thank you. For these 8 projects, and it's not only to rehabilitate them, but also for the accessibility and animation. So I find this very interesting, and we are very lucky to have these projects. Thank you. Victor, as some of my colleagues mentioned, this meeting allows us to see the accomplishments of the NCC during the last few years. But to have taken steps to advance with our dreams. We call this in English imaginaries in English. I mentioned this to my colleagues yesterday. So the imagination, the imaginary, because you're presenting projects that are not finished. So we are dreaming in the nicest way possible. And they are coming to fruition. So it's important that it's whether it's an individual, a group, or an ethnic group, or the nation, we have advanced with these projects that are leading us to a final point of very beautiful projects. You mentioned zero carbon for a pavilion, the new habitats, the safety and accessibility. In a perspective, I've been here for 8 years. Other people have been here for 4 years. We're talking about modernizing the NCC. These are the words of Mark, our chair. This was his objective. It's the mission of this organization to make this capital a great capital and one of the best capitals in the world. And I want to thank you for this effort, because the imaginary is the imagination of the employees that are submitting projects. It's the imagination of committees, such as the this committee that welcomes the best architects, the best to critique and make these projects possible in the context of the imaginary. And we're getting to concrete projects. So congratulations. Thank you, Victor. Michael.
So much has been said about the individual projects. I'd be just repeating how great they are. I think it's I would just urge everyone, staff level, board level, going forward, to remember that we, as excited as we are, we have to contain our enthusiasm, especially when it comes to costs. And you know, these projects can be and should be delivered for a price that is commensurate with what something commensurate with the private sector should pay, and we can never let our enthusiasm for them get out ahead of ourselves, and we trip up on that, because what's beautiful objectively, aesthetically and whatnot, can end up being not so beautiful in some people's eyes if it costs double what it should and whatnot. So it's a challenge, and it's something that you have to stay ever vigilant. And the more good projects you're doing, the more vigilant about it you have to be. Because if we were only doing one, you would have so many eyes on it that you could do it efficiently. But when you're doing this many good things at once, it's easy to lose track. So that's something that I should never be far from the front of everyone's mind. I just want to share that. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael. Mireille.
Merci, Monsieur le Président.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you for this presentation. I find that this presentation that you just made is very useful right now. We are seeing the transformation of our national capital for the better, and you are presenting us these projects that are being done. It is important to have, at the beginning of the spring, and very soon we have the Tulip Festival and other events that will lead us to circulate in this space that is on the map. So it's like an inventory of what we can see, a very interesting project. We are not allowed to enter the site, but we can see from far away what is happening, and we can anticipate, as Denis mentioned, to anticipate the carrying out of dreams that are taking shape in front of us. So thank you very much. I know that I will spend a very nice summer seeing all these projects being led to fruition. Thank you very much, Mrs. Apallon. Deborah.
Of these projects already, to see them all actually together is a little overwhelming, to be honest. And you know, that's not even mentioning some of the other projects that we've already approved or are working on the other side of the river, like the Chaudière Falls or Jacques Cartier Park. What I find so wonderful about all of these projects coming together is the way that they are helping citizens and visitors get connected to the water again, and that the river is going to be its own feature and jewel in the National Capital Region. As I look at this and I see where this is all going, I wish I was running a boat rental business or maybe a water taxi service, because I have a feeling that people are going to get very excited about getting onto the water to see all these things from there. Thanks.
Thank you, Deborah. Mayor Sutcliffe.
It's all very exciting. Thank you for the presentation. Merci.
Thank you, Mayor Sutcliffe.
Thank you.
Thank you. You know, working in various capitals around the world, there's usually one thing that's the image of that capital. And I think we would all say that Parliament Hill is the image of our capital. And it's very important. But I've noticed in most capitals, and I was worried that our capital wasn't going this way in the past, there's usually a second layer of investment to create not just an image of the capital, but an experience of the capital, and a series of experiences that would be relevant to different kind of people in the nation. Whether you're looking at Brasilia or Canberra or Washington, D.C., you're beginning to see that investment. So to see that we've used the funds available to us for maintenance of our assets to identify and highlight certain experiences which really change your visit to the Capitol, I think is really saying that we want the Capitol to be relevant to really all Canadians. Of course, if you live here, it's a pretty nice place to live compared to many cities in our country because of all these amenities. But also, if you're a Canadian elsewhere in the country, I come from the West, it makes it a destination that you really want to come to, and that when you get here, the experience is worth having come to. And so I think that's very important. What I like about these projects is that for the first time, we're seeing Indigenous content built right into these projects from the inception. We're seeing the involvement of the Indigenous people in these processes, evolving them and designing them. And so it's not surface content. This is, I think, very deep-seated content. It reflects the attitude that I've learned, and Norm's the expert here, but that I've learned about the perspective of Indigenous folks when it comes to these kind of projects, the perspective of nature, the perspective of the respect of all the different components that make up the country. But one thing I am hoping that as these projects move forward, that we will put a new energy into, and that is to, while maintaining the new indigenous content, that we will also add the amazing multicultural content of this country. This country, which we used to think of as English and French Canada, is now, you know, 175 cultures, 175 languages living, and we learned this in one of the labs, living in a state of harmony that's unknown in most parts of the world. And I want to see that reflected more in these projects as we move forward. I want to see, you know, the South Asian culture. I want to see the Asian cultures. I want to see the Eastern European cultures that all have come and made Canada their home. And I want them, in the same way that we want our indigenous citizens, to see themselves in this capital. And this is a great opportunity to do that. We've shown that we can do something much more special with the indigenous content. Now we must show that we can do something very special with this amazing multicultural society that we've created, and it needs to be reflected here. I'm seeing the beginnings. I would love to see more in the projects as we move forward. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Larry. Norm.
Thank you very much for the presentation and all the work that you that the team does.
Thank you, Norm. Caroline.
Merci.
Thank you. Thank you for the summary of these group projects. There's 8 that have been presented, but I know that there's many more that are coming, and I think it's important to mention this. I wanted to congratulate you, because we see pictures and we imagine that it's easy, but we know that there's a lot of issues, that technical issues, design issues. There's different comments that come from the different stakeholders, but you welcome all these, and you managed to do exceptional projects. And I want to mention this, because often when it's finished, it's the architecture and the design, it seems like it's coming from as a surprise. But I want to mention that we're all very aware of all the work, and we know that it is more than just a picture. It's a lot of efforts that are behind all this work. And I want to congratulate you. Thank you. Thank you, Caroline Luc.
Well done.
Well, thank you very much, Simon, Justin, Bruno. That was a terrific presentation. Merci beaucoup pour les mises à jour.
Thank you for these updates.
Doing these presentations, Toby, to the upcoming board, it's always good for, especially as a new chair, new members will be introduced, to be made aware of the projects. As I mentioned many times, I was, when I joined, and I've been a resident my whole life in this, pretty well my whole life in this region, I had no idea of the size and scope of the assets and of the projects of the NCC, and I think it's really remarkable. And as Lisa says, I think we're very fortunate that we've had a nationally funded organization investing so much in the National Capital Region. So please keep the new board up to date and the new chair and the public as well, which is obviously a really our audience of which will benefit from these incredible projects. So thank you. Okay, now I think we're coming to the end of the meeting. So hey, by the way, that was one of the most positive meetings. So thank you. I don't know if that was done by design, because it was my last board meeting, but I think it was the quietest we've ever had Toby. Yeah. We never needed him to intervene, and I will have gone 6 years without using this gavel. So, and I'm glad I didn't have, I'm glad that the opportunity for using the gavel was not presented, but thank you for bringing it out anyways, just in case. But given that it is my last board meeting, and given that I have the floor, I'm going to speak for the next 3 hours, and, but I do, but I do hope you do bear with me. Normally, as you know, I like to not be scripted and impromptu, but I did write some comments that I think and some reflections. But it has been 6 years, and it's been fun. It's been challenging. It's been rewarding. It's gone fast.
And it's been a great, you know, it's been a great experience. So I am going to share some reflections, but first, some thank yous. As I mentioned last night to the board, I really do want to thank my wife, Nicole, and my kids, Zoe and Owen, as any of us who are involved, and all of you are involved in serving your community. It takes a lot of time away from the family, away from your regular day jobs, and it takes a commitment, and you can't do that without the support of your family and your partners. So I'm eternally grateful to Nicole for giving me the space and the opportunity, the support, and the sounding board. I've been on boards, started in 2001 with the University of Ottawa. It's been over 20 years of being on boards. I've served with our mayor here on some, and it's a big commitment, and the family needs to be a part of the commitment, so I thank them. I'd like to thank Microsoft Canada. Veronique and I were joking yesterday, the first couple of years, I think I spent, and I shouldn't be saying this publicly, but as much time with the NCC as I did with Microsoft. It was a lot of work, but Microsoft has been terrific in supporting my my role here, giving me the flexibility to be a chair, which requires more than just our board meetings, obviously, but a lot of other engagements, and I really do appreciate Microsoft giving me the opportunity to be involved in such an important organization and giving me the flexibility to do so and the support to do so. Minister Jolie, who appointed me 6 years ago, and subsequent ministers, including Minister Rodriguez, Anand Tassi, and our current Minister Jacek, as well as their respective offices. We work with many of their officials, but the deputy ministers and ministry officials, and so many of the staff members at both Heritage Canada and PSPC. I'd like to thank the members of the local caucus who have that same passion and care deeply about our capital and our local citizens, and I really appreciate the support from local caucus members over the last 6 years. To Mayor Sutcliffe and Mayor Belil, who is not here, as well as former Mayors Watson and Pednaud-Jabin. We talked about this earlier, and you and I have had a conversation. The importance of collaboration, communication is so important between the municipalities. It is a living city, as we know. It is a capital city, and those interjections sometimes have challenges, but the opportunity for greatness lies in that partnership between the NCC and the municipalities and the respective leadership that you have and the roles you play. There will be challenges. I remember that 100-day, what was it, the 100-day plan, whatever, Bob Plamondon, who is, Mark knows as well. There's opportunities to resolve through strong communication collaboration, because we all have the same end game, which is to make the National Capital Region a world-class city that everyone can be proud of. So thank you for the support, the partnerships, not just with yourselves, but with your offices and your officials and your staff. As you mentioned, 35 pages, I couldn't believe that, of projects that you're working, that we're working together. But it speaks to the, and I'm sure Mayor Belil would, and has pointed out numerous projects as well, it speaks to the importance for the partnership. And we're so grateful to have the mayors on our board. So thank you for that. Chantal. The board, I speak on behalf of the board and me personally, in thanking you. You keep us organized. You keep us prepared. There's so many things behind the scenes that you are responsible for, and it runs smoothly like clockwork. And I've gone, you know, for 6 years to know you personally, and it's been an incredible journey together. And I'm going to miss working with you, but I thank you, and I know the rest of the board members thank you for all of the work you do. Luc and Veronique, the chiefs of staff, the corporate secretaries, the ones that I've, you know, work intimately with as well, you know, with Chantal, obviously, and Toby, but thank you, thank you, thank you. Merci beaucoup. Votre rôle est très important.
Your role is very important. The role you continue to play, your advice, your counsels, the impact you have on the board, on the NCC as a whole is exemplary, and it was really a privilege to work with each of you, with both of you, to get to know you better, and I thank you for everything you've done. We have had some highs and some lows, difficult moments and great moments, but we've always done it together and we've always collaborated well. So thank you, Toby, my friend.
Her name's our child after you. It speaks to the impact you have had. And the executive team, all of the members of the executive team. Thank you. The NCC is in great shape. I know I'm leaving this organization in great hands and in great leadership. Toby and team, you've changed the culture. You've brought humility, you've brought access and collaboration across the organization with key stakeholders and our publics. You share a vision of doing the right things for the capital. You face adversity and you deliver results. Toby, you're a team builder. I think you've heard it yesterday in our conversation. You're a problem solver, and I know there's always going to be some challenges, and finding solutions that aren't always apparent is one of your skill sets, so thank you. You're flexible in how you approach things. And finally, you're a friend. I do look forward to beating you at pickleball. And believe it or not, okay, I never thought I'd say we'd be playing pickleball. I used to say pickleball, that's where it is so much fun. And I've had the opportunity to show up on the court with Toby at the RE Center, and I'm looking forward to, at some point, he's a much better racket sport player, but having the opportunity to continue our conversations over a pickleball conversation. So, but thank you, Toby. Your leadership has been tremendous, and executive team, you are all transformative. And I encourage you to, we've surrounded and hired really smart people on this team. You're empowered. Empowerment comes with accountability, but you're empowered. Empower your teams, because when people feel empowered and know that they can do things, the best comes out of them. So continue to have that empowerment, share that empowerment, and do the right things as we go forward. But thank you very much for the incredible leadership. The NCC staff, and there's many of you here in the room and that I've had the opportunity to interact with, it's been a humble pleasure serving you. It really has. You're the foundation of the NCC, and your passion for making the capital one of the world's greatest is having a real impact. You're here because you care about the national capital. You care about the great things that we have to aspire to, and it's the staff that makes things happen. So thank you very much to all the staff of the NCC for the incredible work that you do each and every day. It's a real humble privilege and pleasure to have worked and served for you. And finally, my NCC board colleagues, the board members, what a pleasure it has been to work with you, to learn from you, to serve with you. Board members that are here, but also previous board members who aren't with us today, and future board members that I haven't had the opportunity to work with, but certainly likely had interviewed over the last number of months. It's a national board, and it's funded not by local dollars, but by all Canadians. And board members are appointed from hundreds, and I know this because I go through this process over the last 6 years, hundreds of applicants from across the country, hundreds. I mean, Chantal knows how many days PCO had me going through interviews and applications, dozens and dozens of interviews. So you're all selected. You, current board members and future board members that will be joining, you're selected and appointed from a really rich pool of applicants. And you're selected based on your skill sets, based on your expertise, your experiences, based on demographics. And it's great to see the representation. I think we have equal representatives of gender on this board, which is tremendous. But we have representation of different demographics. We have an Indigenous member, an Algonquin member for the first time. We have different skill sets. That's so important. And as I've said to you from the onset, the biggest sense of diversity that is important is diversity of thought and diversity of opinion, and we cherish that. And I've loved our deliberations on issues, whether in public or on camera. I've loved the fact that people speak their minds and have the opportunity to deliberate issues, because that diversity of thought brings every issue to a better level when you can have respectful, well-prepared conversations. You know, as we've continued to modernize the NCC from top to bottom, and we really have done a modernization from top to bottom of this organization that included our governance model and our board composition. You know, this board represents some of the brightest minds across Canada in their respective fields. It represents diversity in genders, we talked about, in race and backgrounds, in demographics, and most importantly, as I've said, in thoughts and opinions. And when you surround yourself, as I'm very fortunate, with smart people, I want those, you know, it's important that those people be empowered to have their voices heard. And thank you for sharing your voices and your opinions and never having the need to use the gavel because they were done in a respectful manner. To current and past and future board members, serving on the NCC board is a big responsibility and one that comes with very little fanfare. In fact, it comes with a real desire to serve. Members will often need to make tough decisions that may not seem popular to the public eye or to the outside eye, but nevertheless are the right decisions for the future of the National Capital Region as a world-class G7 capital. We're fortunate. We're talking about being a G7 capital, and we have the opportunity to be that. And board members, please continue to prepare yourself as well as you've done in the past. Prepare yourself for board decisions as thoroughly as possible, to read pertinent materials, to gain all relevant perspectives. That's really important when you gain, and that's staff as well. Gain the perspectives from our local constituents, from national constituents, from our stakeholders. But then gain those perspectives, digest those perspectives, and come to the and understand all sides of a decision and to show up ready to make those tough decisions. There are many considerations we have, including local citizens, federal priorities, and representing all Canadians who fund the NCC, environmental considerations, financial considerations, design standards, public realm, public access. In all my years on this board and my hope for future boards, I have been so impressed how members have been so well prepared, remained objective with no personal agendas, and have engaged in strong discussions and collaborated together to provide the right level of oversight, the right level of sober second thought required by board members to make the right decisions affecting the NCC and the NCR for the long-term benefit of the capital. These are not only a responsibility, but a necessity in preserving the integrity and to have good governance. We teach our children that making the right decisions will often mean not making the popular or easy ones. Those are easy when we have the popular and it's easy to take that route. But the right decisions are often the difficult ones. It is sometimes tough to do in light of pressures on board members. But if you can look your peers in the eyes and you can look yourself in the mirror, knowing that you've done what you believe is right, then you will have served your role as an independent and objective director very well. So thank you to my my fellow board members for living those values and for striving to make Canada's capital a world-class capital. You do so for the right reasons, not for any personal gain, and I thank you very, very much for the opportunity to serve with each and every one of you. So now for some reflections. So that was, hey, that's just part one. That was just the thank yous. Now we're going to go into some reflections. Like I said, we're going to be here for a few hours. It's my last meeting, so I have the proof. I got the gavel. So for some reflections of the last 6 years, and I really think these last 6 years have been some of the most challenging for the NCC. And when you listen to this, given the following, I think we'll recognize, sometimes we lose sight of it, but I think we'll recognize. My very first meeting was in the board meeting next door. I think it was the second or third day as chair. And I get sat down in the next door meeting with the Office of the Auditor General and saying, we're going to be releasing a public report that is going to, you know, create some negative publicity for the NCC because it's going to talk about the lack, the high risk of the condition of your assets. And the fact there's been no funding associated for the last 10 years and that your assets are in health and are creating a safety or health concern. That was the very first meeting. And that OAG report, we'll talk about later, but it talked about the risk to the organization. That was step number one. And then a once-in-a-lifetime global pandemic that transformed how we work, how we govern, and how we manage a capital city under lockdown scenarios. Not one, but two historic one in 100 year floods in 2017-2019. That devastated the shorelines of our capital. The transition of CEOs of the NCC and pretty well the entire board and the most of the executive team members over that period of time. And think of this, the key social issues that have transformed our societies over the last 6 years, from residential school graveyards and reconciliation to the Me Too movement, to Black Lives Matter, to gender equity, real important issues that need great reflection and transformation on how we do things. And by the way, we also threw in there Canada's 150 during that period of time. So when you pause and you reflect, so much has happened in the last 6 years. And we've all transformed as organizations, as professionals, and as human beings over that period of time. It's really been a transformative period in our society. But with challenges and adversity come opportunity. The opportunity to transform, to innovate, to change, opportunity to get things done. And having and the OEG report, after having gone more than a decade without any funding of our assets, we can proudly reflect on securing over $600 million over the last 6 years to rehabilitate and bring back to life so many of our key assets. And we saw just the tip of the iceberg today. From Nepean Point, now Kiwiki Point, to interprovincial bridges, pathways, monuments, Gatineau Park, Rideau Hall, Confederation Park, Westboro Beach Pavilion, Lac Philippe. This is just, again, tips of the iceberg, are being transformed as we speak to better serve our public. New shorelines on both sides of the river that now like greater public access, while also being rehabilitated to withstand environmental impacts and damages. Expanding public access to so many of the NCC sites that we saw, but also with the addition of three-season bistros and terraces across various key locations in the region, to the addition of a full-time seasonal shuttle to Gatineau Park, to the expanded opening of parkways for pedestrian and bike access, to the open NCC days when so many of our properties are open to the public, and to the board's immediate and highly effective relaunch of the Le Breton Flats project with a new and approved master plan, which will see a combination of residential, retail, commercial development, along with a massive park, providing key public access to the Ottawa River. And with three key phases of the project already under procurement and underway, including the contract of Dream Le Breton that we heard earlier today, that will build hundreds of affordable housing units in the library district, the MOU with the Ottawa Senators to develop a world-class arena and some surrounding development, to the current final stage of negotiations on the flat phases, which will see 100 more living dwellings being constructed the next couple of years. And then last summer, we saw pathways were being constructed to allow pedestrian access to Le Breton Flats, and as you heard today, animation to bring more life to the site while we also bridge the development of phases of these of Le Breton. You know, and these are a lot of big projects, but I'd say, you know, one of the most impressive thing that I think we can all be proud of is the modernization. the team will hate this. Is the significant modernization of the NCC organization. And I say this because it was one of my theme words coming into the organization 6 years ago, and it's a theme that we've stayed on. How do you modernize the organization? But to modernize the organization, its workforce and its governance. We had a goal to make the organization more accessible, more transparent, more collaborative, more focused, results focused. We had to develop greater relations with our Indigenous partners, a mandate to be a leader in environmental sustainability and protection, and to become more efficient and effective in how we ran the organization. We transformed the board, seeking members who bring the needed skills and experiences, the diversity and varying perspectives. We transformed when and how we meet to become more efficient and to ensure that every member's voice is heard in deliberations. We reorganized our committees and our advisory groups to gain greater efficiencies. We've sought to have board and committee members that are prepared, committed, and passionate about Canada's capital and our role as independent, objective, and caring stewards of the capital. We transformed our leadership group and our staff engagement. We sought to bring pride, humility, collaboration, and access to our teams at the NCC. We sought to modernize our working conditions. We purchased a new headquarters that the NCC will soon move into that will be a leader in innovation and working models. And for all that, we are so proud that for consecutive years, the NCC has been named a top employer of choice of the National Capital Region. So congratulations to the team for that transformation, that modernization that we've been talking about. The NCC is not just a city or a region across the country. It is a living, vital city. It is Canada's capital. It is a G7 capital. It is a world-class city and region. And with that comes responsibility. Responsibility to celebrate our history, recognize and reconcile our past. Responsibility to ensure our capital reflects a vision for the future and reflects the values of Canada and of Canadians that we aspire to. We have the responsibility to ensure Canada's capital reflects the leadership to be the greenest capital, that while honoring our past, our history and heritage, we also look to the future and set standards for design excellence, for innovation and for public realm, and that we demonstrate the highest levels of tolerance, acceptance, diversity and inclusion. The NCC has the responsibility to ensure that Canada's capital region is a world-class capital that all Canadians, whether you're Indigenous, whether you're a new Canadian, whether you're a local citizen, or a Canadian from any and all corners of the country, regardless of your backgrounds or demographics, that all Canadians can feel at home in the national capital and that all Canadians can be proud of. I am proud of our capital. And I am proud of the NCC. There will always be a need for continuous improvement, as making our capital the best in the world is a journey, not a destination. The last 6 years have been a great experience. I have learned so much from each of you, board, staff, executive team, Toby, mayors, stakeholders, learned so much from this experience. I've learned about you more, and gotten to know people on a more personal level, and wow, what great people. You're great human beings, first and foremost. But I've learned a lot about myself, and I've changed grown as a human being, and I believe I leave this organization as a better professional and as a better human being because of this experience. Being chair of any board is a privilege, but the chair is just one voice. It is vitally important to be surrounded by smart, committed and passionate people, and to empower those people to have their voices heard and to have their own impact. It has been such an honor to have worked with all of you here, to have faced adversity and challenges together, to have accomplished so much, and to leave the organization in such great hands and with such a great and promising future. I wish the very best to the next chairperson and offer whatever transition help is needed, but I do so knowing that the NCC and Canada's capital are on very solid ground. I leave feeling proud and excited for the future of our amazing capital region and of the NCC. I thank you for the opportunity and the privilege to have served you.
Well done. Thank you to you.
Thank you. You need to run for something now.
Mark, we can't let the meeting end on that note. As wonderful as that was, and as much as we appreciate your words and your thoughtfulness and your reflections, if I can just say on behalf of the staff how grateful we are for your leadership. And it's really manifested in so many ways. I think the staff really feel the respect you offer to them. That's felt in the organization. People know the chair and the board have our backs. Yes, you've always asked challenging questions. Yes, you want us to do better if we can. But that notion of respect and courtesy is very much understood and appreciated. And you've helped set that tone for us. Second thing, Mark mentioned that it's not just the board meetings where Mark is active with the NCC. Mark and I have a standing meeting every week, Friday morning, 9 o'clock. And those are really important moments for me to get advice from you, to hear your thoughts on strategy, on approaches. And it's important for me to say this because, you know, sometimes people say, oh, Toby, that's a great idea. No, it was Mark's idea. And throughout the time that I've been here, you've always offered me that very sage wisdom, advice and support. And lastly, yes, we do gently mock you for the modernization of the NCC, but it's been great. And modernization for us has really meant an number of things. It's meant openness, it's meant transparency, it's meant accountability. And again, you, through that single-mindedness and single purpose, have really helped set the tone for what I agree with you is a changed NCC, a better NCC, a more accountable, a more open, and a more transparent NCC. So on behalf of all the staff who are here and all the staff who are not, many, many thanks. We really appreciate your leadership.
Thank you, my friend. Thank you. Well, again, thank you very much. And with that, do we have a motion to adjourn?
Denis,
thank you. And with that, maybe, no, I'm not going to use the gavel. Thank you very much again, all of staff, team. It's been a real pleasure. Thank you.